At the dawn of the Age of the Wheel, Xerian miners came across a strange ore they called Prisma, a name given to its beautiful colors and glow. When they brought Prisma before the leaders of the Xerian Council, they were rewarded, as the leaders were very impressed by its beauty. They handed it over to the alchemists of Xeria to study, but word was already out that this new ore would be the means to produce the finest jewels for the aristocracy of Xeria, and the kingdom's economy would soon thrive. However, before the alchemists had concluded their study, orders were issued for the mining of Prisma throughout Xeria. Reports came in weekly from alchemists and scientists regarding Prisma, and some of them were worried for some of its properties. Prisma had a very high capacity for water, which was the main secret behind its impressive colors, its radiance, and its legendary beauty. But once the water was absorbed, the ore turned to a dark stone that generated smoke and even exploded when carved into smaller pieces. More reports came in, stressing these troublesome reviews. But the Xerian leaders would not have it. They had already become obsessed with the idea of profit from this god-given find. Alchemists were sent away or even executed for expressing doubt or worry regarding Prisma. New scientists were brought in, people closer to the council that were easier to manipulate. However, the results were the same. Cutting the stone into pieces would sometimes cause it to explode when sudden pressure was applied. Accidents in labs were kept secret, but rumors had already begun to spread, dividing the scientific community. One day, during a terrible storm, a carriage returning from the mines was thunderstruck. The energy generated from the lightning bolt absorbed the water from the stones instantly, and resulted in a huge explosion that killed tens of miners. Similar events took place throughout Xeria in one of the most terrible storms ever witnessed. Rumors started to spread about a curse from the gods, and the Xerian leaders could no longer ignore the terrible side of the Prisma ore. New orders were issued to dispose of the ore, as it was deemed cursed and useless. But a team of scientists came forward to oppose this view. They convinced the leaders of the council that, with proper processing and careful study, new weapons could be manufactured that could change the world forever. And so, the scientists started to experiment on new weapons. Weapons that caused controlled detonations when pressure was applied upon them. When the process was perfected, the Xerian people became the first people to bear guns made of a new, powerful ore that could stand against anything, even magic. An ore later known as Grimstone. Hello there, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Mildra, and I will be your gaming monk for the evening. You know, in the last few years that I've been doing reviews and interviews, I'd like to think that myself and my brothers here in the temple have helped elevate others' work in some form. It's a lovely contrast to the testing experiences I had with a certain company I won't name, but if you know, you know. I genuinely want people to create, and get better with each creation. I don't bring this up as some kind of ego trip, but because our subject matter is the sophomore attempt of one Angelos Kyprianos, apologies again if I mispronounce your name, who's been featured on this channel more than once. Some of you may recall that I reviewed his previous work, Meteor Tales, last July, a game I said had some interesting ideas, especially in leaning into sword and sorcery fantasy without going full OSR, but it had a very at-the-table vibe, especially with how there were more subsystems instead of a universal resolution setup. This is something I've gotten on early RPGs, as it's an artifact of war games. Generally, it's better to have a unified mechanic than a bunch of subsystems. All roads lead to Rome, as I call it. His sophomore attempt, Grimstone, trades sword and sorcery for gothic fantasy. Taking place in the world of Maia, this is a world based in dualities, a reflection of the two gods, Vestia and Barakan, who represent the sun and moon, and thus the sunborn and moonborn tribes, light and darkness, science and magic, religion and paganism, you get the idea. If some of you are thinking of the likes of Castlevania or Ravenloft, you're not completely far off. However, this is not a sequel or successor to Meteor Tales, it's its own system. For my part, I'll be looking at whether it still has the disharmonious resolution I mentioned before, or if it's been able to build a Rome that all thieves build towards. Additionally, it builds itself on a lethal combat system and freeform development, which I will also take into account. And, if it wasn't obvious enough, I did back Grimstone on Kickstarter, and I've had Angelos on my show more than a few times. I know I say this every time, but that will not play a factor into my assessments. So, with all of that out of the way, it's time for the big question. How does Grimstone hold up? Let's find out. Grimstone is a slimmer game than Meteor Tales at only 125 pages, and there's still the early 2000s habits with how the book is laid out. However, in this case, I feel the book leans into it with an emphasis on a journal-like design instead of using color at all. I'd compare it to the way D&D 3rd edition books were trying to go for an ancient tome look. Essentially, it's less of, this is what we had to work with, and more of, this is the style we wanted to convey. While there's no index, which I do have to give a mark for, I will give it props for having bookmarks this time. Overall, the presentation is an improvement. Character creation is described as a 10-step process in its overview, and we'll be exploring that with Aldine once again. The first step is to choose a nationality, i.e. where on Maia you hail from. Each nationality comes with its own cultural characteristics and native language. In our case, we'll go with Xeria, which means that we have Xera as the native language. Second is tribe, essentially the race of the character. Of the tribes available, we'll go with Sintka. This grants the fast development nature, which gives us an extra feat, as well as the research cultural legacy, though that's not granted immediately. Third is attributes. Much like Meteor Tales, attributes are tier-based instead of straight numbers, with your tribe presenting a starting spread. The three attributes are body, instinct, and mind, each granting a set of derived components, with one free upgrade to your attributes. Regardless, attributes are either low, average, high, or remarkable. As a Sintka, we have average body and instinct, and remarkable mind. We'll apply a freebie to body, raising it to high, which means we'll have the following setup. Body generates a physical combat modifier of +2, a threshold, i.e. hit points, of 40, a vitality or passive defense of 24, and 3d10 in body skill rolls. Instinct generates a reaction count of 1, so 1 reaction per round, 8 movement, a reflex of 1, i.e. we can react to actions of 1 velocity or less, and 2d10 instinct skill rolls. Mind generates 4 variations, a development of 4, which affects our XP growth, a sanity or mental HP of 36, and 4d10 in mind skill rolls. Fourth is senses, or how well the character can see, hear, smell, or a combination of the three. This also determines their grid awareness, or the area of effect that they can detect. Now this is based in one's tribe, and in our case we have a sight of 5, hearing of 5, scent of 5, perception of 15, and grid awareness of 30. I should note here that perception plays a role in Grimstone's stealth system. Essentially, perception is used to counter stealth, but we'll get into that shortly. At this phase, we also grant a niche benefit to one skill, giving us a +1 bonus to the use of that skill. In our case, we'll go with observation as our niche. Since we have gained a feat from our tribe's nature, this is a good time to talk about feats. As tempting as it is to compare them to feats in D&D, it's more akin to the more granular talent advancements you'd see in a CRPG. Each feat has 4 levels which provide stacking benefits. Now in our case, we'll go with acrobatics, which is going to give us the evade maneuver. Fifth is domains, the areas of expertise for a character, and the actions that expertise grants. Now this could be considered your class features, in a sense. The starting domains and variations you have is determined by mind, and we have 4 of them. The more variations you have in a given domain, the larger the amount of d10s you roll with those variations. Additionally, each domain has a set of default maneuvers that are added to the choice of actions available. In our case, we'll put all 4 into traditional weapons. This means we have the disarm, jab, quick parry, and lacerate variations. This also means our domain level with traditional weapons is basic, so we roll 3d10 when using those variations. Finally, equipment. There isn't a set listing for starting equipment, more of a GM fiat thing. In our case, we'll go with a rapier for our weapon, as well as a full set of studded leather armor. In addition, a quick belt with 1 healing elixir. Character creation goes down a bit smoother than it did in Meteor Tales, but there's a few perplexing moments. I find it interesting that it doesn't use levels while it still uses XP thresholds in a manner that may as well be. In addition, I don't think feats as presented are powerful enough to justify only 4 feat slots across the XP progression. I know the game's going for a darker style of fantasy, but given the options presented in the domain system, it's odd. The whole time I was wondering if this would be better served going more freeform with XP as currency, but I'm still not 100% on that yet. There's a lot that's good, but there's some old habits that haven't been completely shaken off. Grimstone relies on D10-based pools in what it calls an effectiveness roll. Essentially, you roll a number of d10s based on what's being used and compare that to a target number. There's no critical or botch equivalent, it's all about pass or fail on the roll. A skill roll is a set of d10s based on the attribute listed. A maneuver roll is based on the domain's level, generated by the number of variations as mentioned before. Basically, all roads lead to these 10-sided die pools. Interestingly, there's no initiative stat. Instead, initiative is a d10 roll to determine what segment on a 10-second period that individual acts in. This can be generated in a d10 roll or with playing cards a la Savage Worlds. Beyond that, movement is its own resource that has a set of options as listed on the character sheet. As for attacking, that is dependent on the domain used for the attack. There's no equivalent to passive defense or armor class in the traditional sense. Instead, defending from an attack requires a reaction, and those will only come at a limited amount. Ranged attacks and spells, however, are affected by distance, subtracting one from the result for each cell, in addition to modifiers from placement and cover. Regardless, successful attacks always inflict wounds, with an anatomy roll determining where wounds end up hitting. The more wounds accumulated in a given area, the greater the effect. All this combines to create a system that is highly lethal, and one where wading through combat creates large risks. I do think it's a bit favorable to ranged combat, however, and the way toxicity works with spellcasting is something I think should be modified by attributes, but that's just me. When I covered Meteor Tales, I said that it felt like a game made for a table rather than something more universal. While some of that is present in Grimstone, it's not as blatant this time around. The D10-based design definitely has a better sense of unity, but I feel like certain parts of the design were an act of habit more than anything else. Character advancement especially is an instance of this. As it is, however, I think Grimstone can get a stamp of recommended. Now, I can't recommend it to everyone, and there's a few things that I might house rule personally, but it has a much stronger identity than its predecessor. That said, I do think it needs a far larger bestiary. I'm giving it the recommended stamp based on the strength of what it presents, as I think there's a path to its true potential. To that end, I want to see more of what this world has to offer, be it through adventures or a GM's handbook. Stay frosty!